Hello and welcome. I'm Mike Scott and I'm delighted that you've joined us today for this new Zoom series, Cultural Encounters, Books That Have Made a Difference. In this series, we're bringing together scholars and their audiences in order to explore themes of encounter in literary works and contemporary cultural debates. Today, we have the celebrated internationally renowned scholar Terry Eagleton, who opened our first series in person in Oxford in November 2018. I'm very pleased to say that he's returning today via Zoom to speak in this first of this new series, The Future of the Humanities Project. Terry Eagleton's work, Literary Theory, An Introduction, 1983, has sold over 750,000 copies, but is one of many books he's written over the years. In his book On Evil, he shows how his own interpretations develop and change over time, demonstrating in doing so the integrity of his scholarship. His book, Critical Revolutionaries, is deficient in one respect, and that is that he gives an incisive view of T.S. Eliot, I.A. Richards, William Empson, F.R. Leavis, and Raymond Williams, but not of himself. He is, of course, amongst their company in fame, if not always in agreement. Today is to talk on the New Testament in its cultural confrontation with the Roman Empire. If any questions occur to you during this talk, please type them in using the Q&A button, but not the chat button. The Q&A button, please. These questions will come to me, and towards the end, I will put them to Terry, as many questions as I can for him to answer. With that, over to you, Terry.
The idea of culture has become something of a buzzword, you might say, in our time. It's a highly fashionable concept, and you can find it almost everywhere you look. I mean, there's gun culture, beach culture, deaf culture, police culture, Microsoft culture, Tasmanian culture, and a lot more. The idea of culture might therefore be in danger of a certain inflation, I think, at the moment, and one wonders why exactly it's become so modish. Well, there are lots of reasons for that, I think, but here are just two of them, neither of which is particularly positive. The first is the great tidal waves of migration of peoples across the globe at the moment, arising basically from war, starvation, unemployment, extreme inequalities of income, of wealth, all of which then pitches people together in what's known as multiculturalism. Second, however, quite different from that, one reason why culture has become so salient a concept is that it no longer means simply a bunch of artists or writers, composers, painters, but in the 20th century came for the first time in human history to mean an enormous industry, constituting a massive chunk of material production in advanced capitalist societies. Culture, which once saw itself as sublimely transcendent of wealth and property and investment and commodity production, is now one of the major forms that these things take. At the same time, there's been a seismic shift, I think, in the whole role played by culture in a wider political society, because part of the classical idea of culture was that it was, in a sense, the solution to a set of problems. We were divided in various ways in everyday life, and so we needed a place where we could stand together, come together, and experience our shared humanity as something that could cut far deeper than class or race or gender or social inequality, something which distilled the very essence of our humanness. And this was traditionally one of the meanings of culture. It offered the possibility of unity at a very fundamental level in a society which was in grave conflict with itself. And since conflict can be politically subversive, culture had, in a broad sense of the word, a political function in binding our social wounds. All that then changed in the 20th century, when what happened, I think, was that culture, far from being an ideal solution to a set of actual problems, instead became part of the problem itself. It now became the very language in which social and political conflicts were formed and articulated. Culture, in a word, could no longer save us. As the first idea of culture, the idea of culture as a solution, could. And that offered to save us because that idea of culture was itself a surrogate form of religion. Culture, like religion, had its high priests and its hierarchies and its ceremonies and its communal rituals and its universal truths. When religion begins to fail, a certain notion of culture begins to take over. One of the great advantages of that idea of culture was that culture is, as it were, portable, in the sense that you can carry your common humanity around with you in the shape of a volume of Virgil or Shakespeare. You could hand this to somebody to show them the kind of thing that you stood for, to show them what your civilization was about. You could hand it in particular, say, to colonial subjects, instead of giving them long, boring lectures on the English Constitution. You could give them certain cultural totems, so to speak, that could be shared. That meaning of culture today, that meaning of culture is different, however, from today's culture as, gun culture, beach culture, and so on. The rapidly expansionist idea of culture, which is now coming our way, and about which I confess I'm to some degree skeptical. Culture is rapidly becoming, in advanced capitalist society, the new foundation of humanity. There have been all kinds of foundations, of course, in the past: God, the human subject, the human species itself, history, material production, and so on. But it's now culture which is becoming increasingly foundational, meaning that fundamental level of being which you can't dig deeper than, which you can't get behind, because when it comes to being human, it goes all the way down. That's, if you like, the ideology of culturalism, that culture is what in human affairs goes all the way down. You can't ask where culture comes from, for example, because you would have to frame the questions and the answers in cultural terms. And so you would presuppose what you were trying to explain. Now, I happen to belong to the small and persecuted minority of human beings who doesn't believe that culture is foundational in our affairs. I also belong to another minority, by the way, which you might be interested to hear about. I belong to that small persecuted group of people who have never sent an email or been online. So you better look at me closely now, because we're almost an extinct species. It's like looking at people who've never had a wash or, slept in a bed, and soon will be found only in fairgrounds where little children can poke at us to see if we're real. My own view of modern technology is that it's all really an attempt to slow life down. This is a digression, but I hope you don't mind. I mean, in the old days, you would check into a hotel and the receptionist would sign your name in a book and give you a key, and that was all there was to it. Nowadays, you try and check into a hotel and the guy behind the desk starts writing his novel, and you wait for 20 minutes while he copes with some particularly tricky piece of plotting or character development, and then he looks up and realizes that he ought to be checking you in, not writing his novel. However, back to what I was arguing before that grouse, I don't believe that culture goes all the way down, and I don't believe that because I'm a materialist, which means that in my view, human beings are not in the first place cultural constructs, but lumps of natural material stuff, some admittedly lumpier than others. And whatever more glamorous and sexy things human beings can get up to, they have to get up to them, a materialist believes, within that context. I'm not incidentally saying here, I think anything, that the greatest of all Dominican theologians, Thomas Aquinas, wouldn't have agreed with. Aquinas held the orthodox Christian view that God is an animal, namely the Word made flesh. He also held the orthodox Christian view that heaven is a material affair, not a matter of the immortal soul, but of the transformation of the flesh, otherwise known as the resurrection of the body. We're not lumps of material plus something called a soul. Rather, the word soul or spirit, I think, is just a way of describing the distinctive kinds of bodies that we are, how we differ from lumps of material stuff like, you know, mobile phones or garbage cans. How, in other words, we're personal, relational, communicative, expressive, self-determining, self-transformative bodies, all of which I think is what's meant by the soul. So what relevance does all this have to the idea of culture? Well, simply, I think that this for me is true of all human bodies, whatever their color or gender or sexual orientation, whether they're Norwegian or Peruvian, and that human animals therefore have a lot more in common, simply by basis of what they share materially, than some apostles of culture will concede. And I think in that sense, it's true that culture doesn't go all the way down. Two people from entirely different cultures can cooperate to save a third person from drowning, for example. Culture, what we think and feel and value, is ultimately based on what we do. And quite a lot of what we do, not all of it, but quite a lot of it, is universal to our species. You know, laughing, eating, working, grieving, making love, having to listen to boring elderly English academics, and so on. It's true, of course, that these activities are all culturally inflected or articulated in often very different ways, but that's a much more modest claim that nobody's really going to dispute. There are, of course, therefore, many different cultures, but I don't think that means, as most people seem to believe these days, that diversity is a good in itself. Diversity isn't a good in itself. You know, it's not good to have 50 fascist parties rather than just a modest two or three. Nor is inclusiveness a good in itself. Is it good to be included in an apartheid state? It depends on what you're being included in. As Sam Goldwyn remarks, include me out. These are simply postmodern mantras, examples of lazy thinking. I'm not, of course, claiming that culture is unimportant, far from it, just that it's not foundational. there's one sense in which it's highly important, which is that at the centre of our being as material creatures, there's a huge hole. And if culture doesn't enter into that hole fairly quickly after we're born, then we're going to die. I don't mean, you know, that if culture in the sense of Balzac or Beethoven or David Bowie don't enter into us when we're born, we're going to die. I mean culture in a much broader and deeper sense of nurture, networks of caring, institutionalized compassion of one kind or another. All human beings are born prematurely, unfinished, incomplete, unable to look after themselves. And if culture in this broader sense doesn't move in on them pretty quickly at birth, then they won't survive. Culture in this broad sense is what we live by, whereas only a few, you know, people live by reading Proust or playing the trombone. Culture in that narrower sense. Unlike some other animals, we can't just be born, stagger to our feet, lick ourselves down, and gallop off into the middle distance. We can't do this because we have an unusually prolonged period of dependency on our carers. And if Sigmund Freud is to be believed, this is where all our troubles begin. But that's another story. If different cultures, in the sense of distinctive ways of life, if they coexist, then presumably we should respect those which are different from our own. I mean, these people may think and behave differently from ourselves, their customs and traditions may strike us as alien. But the point surely is to try to understand them and to be open to their otherness. I take it that this is part of the ideology of multiculturalism. We should seek to grasp the world from their point of view of the other, and so move more deeply into sympathy with it. This is a very strange idea because, you know, grasping the worldview of sex traffickers is unlikely to make you more sympathetic to them. Indeed, the more you understand them, how they work, how their minds function, how they feel, culture, another culture, the more you might abhor them. The idea lurking around here somewhere, I think, is that we are essentially transparent to ourselves, but others are opaque to us, and so we should seek to dissolve the opaqueness of the other by dialogue, encounter, mutual understanding, inviting each other to the opera, and so on. But if there's one insight to be gleaned from the thought of late modernity, it's surely that being transparent to ourselves is the very last thing that we are. In fact, a certain blindness, a certain self-blindness, is what enables us to operate. And this applies to whole cultures as much as it does to individuals. In the second place, if others were entirely impenetrable to us, we couldn't recognize them as human beings in the first place. So this whole model, this whole liberal model, well-intentioned though it may be, I think needs to be radically rethought. Let me just consider one particular culture whose activities and ways of seeing may strike us as other, as far removed from our own. I'm talking about bankers. Now, at first sight, some of their activities may not seem too appealing. In fact, if you think back to the financial crash of 2008, you'll find that bankers who were busy concocting formulae so complicated that not even themselves could understand them, managed to bankrupt many thousands of ordinary people and got clean away with it. None of them went to prison, and the state stepped in to rescue them with taxpayers' money, that's to say, with the hard-earned cash of the very kind of people that these guys had just ruined. But that, you might say, is the kind of thing bankers do. That's their culture. I mean, who are we to judge them? And where would we have to be standing in order to do so? Either we're standing within a culture we share with the bankers, in which case we can't get the kind of distance we need to judge them, or we're standing somewhere else entirely, in which case our critique isn't relevant to them at all. How far in and how far out do you have to be? Bertolt Brecht once said, only somebody inside a situation can judge it, and he's the last person who can judge. It's a bit the same with aliens. Bankers are a bit like aliens in more senses than one. What's striking about aliens, of course, is that they are never really alien. I mean, they may be green and smell of sulfur and not know who Britney Spears is, but otherwise, you know, they look pretty much like Charlie Sheen, or particularly for the English who are here, like William Hague and Dominic Cummings. They may have spooky eyes, but at least they have eyes, and they may take an excited interest in human genitals and speak in robotic voices, but at least they speak. So how alien are they? Strangely enough, they travel apparently for millions of light years, and then they crash in the Nevada desert. Aliens are testimony to the limits of the human imagination. The real aliens, of course, are those who are sitting in our laps right now, of whom we can know nothing. So the problem would seem to be that if we can understand somebody, you know, feel our way into their way of life, like bankers, we share a culture with them, and to that extent, we can't occupy an external or Olympian standpoint from which we can make definitive judgments on them. While if they're entirely other or alien to us, then we can say nothing about them at all, not even that they exist. This is a wholly false problem, in fact, but a lot of people these days behave as though it isn't. So we might have to conclude that ripping other people off as part of your living is just part of banking culture. I mean, we do things one way and they do them another, and who's to judge between us? I mean, who can decide whether bankrupting great masses of men and women is better or worse than bringing them food through the Gaza Strip? Wouldn't we need some absolute standard to determine this, one which stood at some external point altogether? Indeed, isn't, for some people it would seem to be, isn't the whole idea of judgment elitist? I mean, who's to say that reading Jane Austen is better than listening to Tucker Carlson? I should add that this befuddled way of thinking, which is technically known as postmodernism, is an intellectual affliction which has addled some of the finest brains from Sydney to San Diego. I was asked to talk about a cultural encounter. An encounter is a polite, respectable kind of word, and since I don't much like polite, respectable words, I'm going to talk instead about cultural confrontation. The whole concept of encounter evades the idea of confrontation. But speaking of conflict, I should first of all inevitably say a word about the war, which is being fought as I speak, or rather two words. Firstly, that Hamas's assault on Israel on October the 7th was a moral obscenity. And secondly, that there is nothing Hamas did to Israel which Israel hasn't done to the Palestinians again and again over the decades. That, however, isn't what the BBC wants to hear, let alone CNN. I don't remember, by the way, that the United States' so-called campaign of shock and awe in Iraq, unleashed against Iraqi citizens, innocent Iraqi citizens some years ago. I don't remember it being described as terrorism, though of course it was. Though I imagine that terrorism was probably the way that the Nazis described the activities of the French resistance in the Second World War. The cultural confrontation I want to look at very briefly is between a little known document called the New Testament. I say little known because certainly in the Catholic school I attended, this was in the early years of the Napoleonic Wars, it was never mentioned once. The New Testament was never mentioned once, let alone read. And on the other hand, the Roman Empire, because it seems to me plain that you can only really understand the gospel against the background of one of the most brutal forms of imperialism that history has ever known. Take, for example, the Roman official who sentenced Jesus to be executed, Pontius Pilate. I mean, the Gospels present Pilate as a fairly decent kind of character with a metaphysical turn of mind, reluctant to exercise his powers, a liberal, slightly vacillating type, possibly a Guardian reader or a New York Times reader maybe, certainly not a Fox TV enthusiast. Now, we happen to know that none of this is true. It's all a big lie. The Pilate presented by the New Testament is a shamelessly whitewashed figure, historically speaking. We know quite a bit about Pilate, and he was an absolute brute. You know, he wasn't a Guardian reader in the least. He was a man who could have executed his own grandmother at the drop of a hat. And indeed, he was, in the end, dismissed from the Roman imperial service for dishonorable behavior and corruption of various kinds. And, you know, you had to be pretty dishonorable to be kicked out by the Romans. It would be a bit like being kicked out of Hollywood for being insincere. The punishment that Pilate dishes out, crucifixion, to Jesus, was reserved by the Romans only for two types of victim: absconding slaves and political rebels. The two thieves, so-called, the people between whom Jesus is said to have died, were almost certainly not thieves, but zealots, members of the anti-imperial guerrilla movement of the time, memorably satirized in Monty Python's Life of Brian. Samuel Beckett once remarked that one of the two thieves being saved was, he said, a reasonable percentage. Barabbas, the prisoner released in Jesus's place, was probably a zealot too, as probably were a few of Jesus's immediate comrades. One of them is actually named as a zealot. It's doubtful, I think, perhaps, that Jesus himself was a zealot, though somebody at the time might have thought it convenient to pretend that he was, as a way of getting rid of him and restoring peace, unity, stability, and prosperity to a turbulent nation. A great many crimes have been committed in the name of peace, unity, stability, and prosperity. My point is just that whether Jesus was a zealot or not, and who knows, is that we're talking about a political execution. Or as my dear friend, the great late Dominican theologian Herbert McCabe used to say, the message of the gospel is very clear. If you don't love, you're dead. And if you do, they'll kill you. And they did. You know, there's your pie in the sky for you. There's your religious consolation. Jesus was murdered by the imperial state, or if you prefer, by what the gospel calls the powers of this world, the always potentially violent system of power, wealth, and privilege, which ruled humanity then and does so today. And it seems for the New Testament, at least, that between this and the gospel, there's absolutely no possibility of compromise. You're either with the one or you're with the other. So we're not talking here about encounter. We're not talking about negotiating, you know, dual identities or ambiguities. We're talking about confrontation, and we're not talking about seeking to understand the Pontius Pilates of the world. We're talking about seeking to abolish them. Only middle-class liberals think that there's something bad about confrontation as such. And it's true, of course, that the world is full of eminently negotiable conflicts of various kinds, but there are also some of them which someone is going to have to win and somebody is going to have to lose. There's an astonishing scene in Luke's gospel in which Mary, pregnant with Jesus, meets her cousin Elizabeth, who is pregnant with John the Baptist, in a rather pleasing symmetry. There's joy and celebration, perhaps, between the two women, but the scene is tinged with a darker edge too. Both babies will grow up to be men executed by the state. And this is no convenient, this is no conventional domestic encounter. Elizabeth is beyond the usual childbearing age, for one thing, and for another thing, Mary is so much a radical separatist that she doesn't rely on what the gospel calls the will of man, even to get pregnant. So what do the two women talk about? Diapers? Know any good midwives? No. Extraordinarily, they talk about politics, which in the context is inseparable from talking about theology. Mary has in her womb the mercy, peace, love, humility, and forgiveness, which provide the antidote to the Roman Empire under which she lives, and which will bring all such outfits to nothing in the fullness of time. And remarkably, Luke puts into Mary's mouth what some New Testament scholars regard as a zealot chant, kind of thing that the zealots might have chanted, about the powerful, the mighty being brought low and the lowly raised up, almost a cliche of the Hebrew scriptures, that you will know who Yahweh is when you see the poor being filled with good things and the rich sent empty away. For the gospel writers, this mighty revolutionary reversal has been accomplished in principle already in the belly of an obscure young Jewish woman from a provincial backwater. I mean, Galilee was, you know, real country bumpkin territory, about whom we know hardly anything. Well, the Roman Empire fell and others rose. Imperialism today takes the form of a globally integrated economic system, largely under the sovereignty of the United States, though not a undisputed sovereignty, in which by and large the rich are filled with good things and the poor are sent empty away. What's presented usually as a defense of freedom is more accurately a defense of corporate profits. One quick example to end with. We remember 9/11, of course, but not so much the previous 9/11. I mean, the one which took place exactly 30 years before the destruction of the World Trade Center. 30 years before the destruction of the World Trade Center, almost exactly, was when the democratically elected leader of Chile, Salvador Allende, was violently overthrown by the United States and the CIA, and an odious dictator installed instead in his place, who went on to torture and murder far more people than died in the World Trade Center. but you won't hear much about that on CNN either. And on that hopeful and buoyant note, I'll bring my remarks to a close.
Thank you very much, Terence, for a terrific talk as ever. You raised a number of issues, and if people have got questions, I'd be grateful if you'd type them through, and they'll come through to me. This one come in from Richard Vorgemann. He said, as you said, the New Testament is little known. What do you make of the majority of Shakespeare scholars who show no interest in Shakespeare's deep intertextual engagement with the Bible? Hannibal Hamlin shared this observation with me.
That's an interesting point. I haven't really thought about it. Shakespeare, of course, is extremely deep in the Bible, deep in the Bible, not, of course, in a scholarly or academic way, but in a form of popular culture. Right? That's one of the most fascinating aspects, I think, of Shakespeare's involvement with the scriptures. I think maybe we're talking here about a certain kind of scriptural semi-literacy on the part of modern Shakespearean scholars, you know, who are perhaps not as interested in this vital source of inspiration for Shakespeare as they ought to be. But it's really not something I'm afraid I've thought about very much.
Thanks for that. Can I ask you about Francis Bacon and what is truth, said Jesting Pilate, and would not stay for an answer? You know, how do you interpret that from the Bible to Bacon, to what you're saying today?
When I said Pilate had a metaphysical turn of mind, that's what I was referring to,
right.
The thing, what is truth. What's so elusive about that phrase, surely, is the tone, isn't it? I mean, how does he say it? Does he say it in a kind of wistful way? Does he want to know the truth? Or does he say, what is truth, in a cynical kind of way? You can read it either way. The kind of Pilate that I think is historically accurate, as I try to outline, would probably have said it in a cynical kind of way. But you know, who knows? The two possibilities needn't be entirely opposite. There may have been a kind of, you know, flash of interest in something other than just executing a lot of people in Pilate's encounter with Jesus.
Bacon goes on to talk about the love of the lie, applying the politician's love of the lie, which still is fashionable today, let's say.
Well, I'm again actually in a minority over this, just as I am in over email. I think that politicians try really hard not to lie. Yes, I, you know, my heart is so deeply charitable when politicians are concerned, you know, that I want to give them the benefit of the doubt. Politicians tie themselves up in knots and look utterly ridiculous for one reason, because they're trying not to lie. Why are they trying not to lie? Because if they're found out, that's the end. The art of politics is to lie without explicitly doing so, I think, or part of the art of politics. The penalty for being caught out in a barefaced lie, and, you know, how many barefaced lies Boris Johnson told will be very, very hard to calculate. But the penalty is very severe. You know, I mean, I suppose our political system retains enough shreds of morality to believe that people who lie should be slung out. And therefore, you know, I think, you know, politicians really struggle not to lie. If they have to lie, they will do so. But they do so with a certain reluctance.
Would you equate that with equivocation, Terry?
Yes. I mean,
Henry Garnet.
Politics as the art of equivocation. Yes, of saying one thing and implying another or meaning another. It's the language of calculated ambiguity, which has to address several conflicting audiences simultaneously. But that's very different, I think, from simply denying an outright denial of the truth. Pilate, of course, is a kind of proto-postmodernist because he's calling into question the very concept of truth. You know, I mean, it's one thing to believe in the concept of truth and yet continually violate it. It's quite another thing to do what so many thinkers have been doing in our own time, which is to question the validity of the concept of truth itself, certainly of, you know, a lot of traditional concepts of truth. And that's an inevitable result, isn't it, of the meeting between truth and power, where power steamrolls truth, and where what matters is what you can get done, the promotion of your interests. If particular truths help in that, fine. If they don't, then they're simply expelled.
We go back to the title of our whole project, which you kindly set in motion for us in 2018, which is to do with the humanities and the reasons for the humanities, and then go back to Bacon, who said truth is so hard to tell, it sometimes needs fiction to make it plausible. Is truth a function of fiction?
No, I don't think that truth is a function of fiction, unless you take a very broad and deep view of fiction, which is, as it were, the very symbolic frameworks within which we live. All of our propositions, whether true or not, but all of our propositions that are candidates for truth or falsehood, move within a whole symbolic frame of assumptions and ways of seeing and conventions and agreed perceptions and so on. And if you want to call that a fiction, then yes, fine, you can do that. But I think that's very different from the other way you can see the relation between fact and fiction there is that if a novelist, say, really wants to develop what he or she thinks is the truth of a character or a situation, they might find themselves having to resort to fiction. Yes. For example, it's a strange fact that Florence Nightingale survived into the 20th century, but she shouldn't have done. You know, that's just one of the contingencies of history. If you're writing a novel about Florence Nightingale, you might find it much more convenient, you know, to have her die in the middle of a Victorian war, for example. So there is a sense in which reality, history, doesn't always get things exactly right from the viewpoint of symmetry, for instance, and that fiction then steps in and tries to, as it were, correct and reform reality in order to bring it into line with what it thinks should have happened or more typically would have happened.
Thank you. Molly Clark asks a question here. Hello, Molly. Thank you so much for the enjoyable and fascinating talk. I wonder if you could speak about St. Paul. Is he at odds with the mood of anti-colonial confrontation in the Gospels, or is he doing this as well, but in a different way?
Gosh, I wish I had 3 days to think about that. I haven't thought about Paul. And I mean, again, you know, we're hampered by not knowing enough, aren't we? Paul would seem on the face of it to invite his people to respect the authorities. Yeah. Now, whether that's because he believed in the authorities or whether it was vital to the survival of the early church that they did so is a different matter. One reason why figures like Paul may not have been so concerned with, well, with politics in general, I suppose you might say, is because they really did think that all that was finished. You know, I mean, they had a thoroughly eschatological view of the world, which didn't include the possibility of secular history, you know, that there was still a history for us to work out. Jesus was imminently to come again. Paul certainly seems to believe that. Jesus seems to believe that at times. And all you should do is stand surrendered in faith to the Messiah. There's no room for the cut and thrust of the political or the turbulence and turmoil of the historical in that view. So I think perhaps we have to be careful not to read back into the early church a certain conception of progress or development or dialectic or whatever it happens to be, which is really very modern.
Just came to me then in that answer, going back to the crucifixion itself, and you know, you've got one good thief and one bad thief on either side. So if this were a fiction, it's a confrontation of good and bad with something in the middle, do you think?
Well, I don't think that Jesus is actually in the middle. I think that's where the argument breaks down. The figure Jesus comes across in the Gospel is a very uncompromising figure. You know, I mean, he's not nice. He's not pleasant, you know, in a drawing room sense. You know, he says, either you're for me or against me. And there's a kind of extremism built into Christianity. You know, if you don't take your cross and follow him, then... I'm not sure that I would agree with that image entirely, nor, of course, as I said, do I think that they were thieves anyway. Thieves is a kind of euphemism for what they were. I once got into terrible trouble on, I think I gave a talk on the BBC many years ago, maybe it was Easter time, and I mentioned how, on the whole, Jesus got off pretty lightly at the crucifixion, and my, you know, mailbag was bulging full for months later of people, outraged Christians who promised to pray for my immortal soul, but deeply doubted I had one in the first place. But actually, he did get off pretty lightly. I'm not saying that crucifixion is a walkover, but a lot of people who were crucified, and don't forget, the point of crucifixion was a public humiliation and declaration of powerlessness, that these guys who dared to rise up against the Roman Empire, look how pathetically powerless they are, hanging there. Yeah, that was the point of crucifixion. Not in the first place the pain, though the pain, of course, was excruciating, the word that comes from crucify, but that to die in 6 hours, apparently, on a cross is a lot better than it could be. Some victims of crucifixion thrashed around for days on end. Probably, if the gospel is to be believed, it was the scourging which helped him on his way. If you lose a lot of blood before they crucify you, you die a lot quicker. So, the kind of popular Christian piety, which this is the very worst torment that one could ever experience, alas, I think is dubious.
Does that make it more, well, at least give a probability within the context of the quest of the historical Jesus, that whatever happened, the narrators had made a story rather than recorded a reality?
I think there's reality there enough, but like reality in general, it comes in bits and pieces and different aspects and angles, and somebody has to try and piece that together. I think one of the most interesting features of the presentation of the crucifixion of the gospel is the Gethsemane incident, the Garden of Gethsemane, when he is sweating blood really about the prospect of his impending execution. Why are the gospel writers so keen on inserting that that little cameo or scene? Because they want to show that he doesn't want to die. He's not mad, you know. This is not some kind of crazed masochism. You know, that this is an encounter he would love to avoid if he could, but for some reason he can't. The martyr is not somebody who willingly gives away their life in the sense that they don't reckon much to their life anyway, so why not give it away? The martyr is the person who gives up what is most precious to him or her, namely their life. And therefore, it means that sacrifice means something. Sacrifice only means something if you give up something which you regard as precious. There's no sacrifice in, you know, drinking a pint of diesel every day, you know, or giving away something that you didn't value in the first place. The martyr is called upon, but wishes that he or she wasn't, to surrender what is indeed the ultimate, their own body. Their own body is turned into a kind of sign, that there are some principles so important, and would there weren't, but this is the kind of world we seem to have ended up with, there are some principles so important that you would really have to die rather than to have them denied to people, have those truths and kinds of justice and so on be denied to people. The genuine martyr is aware of what a miserable and unfortunate and tragic figure he or she cuts, you know, rather than running in some starry-eyed way towards their celestial destiny, spurning the world as so much garbage, you know. That's very, very far from the way that the crucifixion is presented.
More questions have come in. This is from Carol Grobicki. If we create a space, perhaps between two or three people, where people can talk without threat or fear, surely we can break down the opaqueness we have to each other.
Well, I think that's I would characterize that as a liberal rationalist position. And though I have, you know, a degree of respect for that, I think what it ignores is the power of material interests. You know, it's not just people don't just disagree because they misunderstand each other or because there isn't sufficient dialogue, or they disagree, they conflict because there are built-in conflicts of material, social, political, and other kinds of interests in the world. Yeah? And it's not just a matter of getting together and sorting them out. You know, if you try and get together and sort them out in a certain kind of way, they will shoot you down in the street. Yeah? And we've had many, many examples of that in our time, even quite recently. One has to accept with full reality the opposition and contradiction of interests in our world that runs so deep that some people are prepared to kill for them and other people are prepared to be killed. That world, that sphere, is very far, I'm afraid, would it were not, from people getting round a table and talking about it. You know, the Victorians made this mistake. You know, Victorian novelists with the best will in the world thought the problem about the rich and the poor was they didn't understand each other. And if only the one side could talk to the other and understand each other, then they might come together. The problem had nothing to do with a breakdown of communication. Yeah? Some of the rich in Victorian England knew exactly how the poor lived. Yeah? It had to do with much more real and material factors. And what we see, to go back to the example of the New Testament, is a document which is, you know, all about the way in which You can't simply transcend the conflicts, contradictions which come to a head in the crucifixion by either being pleasant to each other or by trying to understand each other. Would one could.
Thanks for that. Thomas Banchoff says, you suggested that the idea of encounter downplays the reality of conflict, but the word includes the Latin root contra, and in that recognizes the reality of some opposition. Could you talk a bit more about how encounter relates to confrontation in your thinking?
Well, yes, he's right etymologically there. But contra in Latin can simply mean over against. It doesn't necessarily involve the idea of conflict. But encounter can lead to confrontation or vice versa. You might begin confrontationally and then discover some common ground. Or, don't forget the opposite, you might have some common ground and then gradually real and intransigent oppositions, clashes of interest are revealed. So you can never entirely predict that. I want to argue that encounter and confrontation need not ultimately be at odds with one another, but if an encounter is really meaning something, is real, then it begins to involve struggle. Whereas it seems to me that at the moment, the liberal language of dialogue, reciprocity, mutuality, encounter suppresses, what are really, so many blockages and obstacles, which will not just be dissolved away. And I'm very wary of languages which seem to me to do so.
Thank you for that. Cecilia Pat, hello Cecilia, good to have you with us today. What would you say about Plato's prophecy that the truly good man is doomed to be killed in shameful circumstances?
I think there's a great deal in it. That's what I meant when I quoted theologian Herbert McCabe, if you don't love, you're dead. If you do, they'll kill you. That is surely the intolerable realism of the Christian gospel. Away from all the pie in the sky and the clap happiness and the continual grinning. I sometimes think that certain Christians, certain evangelical Christians, think that Christianity is all about grinning, really, and large smiles on their faces. Grin and everything's okay. The deep fragility of goodness, which comes through in Plato's thoughts, its vulnerability to a world which is perfectly prepared to steamroller it in the name of its own power and its own interests. And yet the fact that neither the Platonic figure nor the figure in the New Testament are prepared to back down, therefore. And of course, one word that we often use for that conflict is that confrontation is tragedy. The crucifixion is a tragedy. It's interestingly, it's tragic, but it's not heroic. I'm moving a little away from your question here, I'm sorry, but Jesus is a tragic figure. But it's not a heroic one. The whole cast and tone of the Gospels is anti-heroic. It doesn't belong to that world of aristocratic glory, in other words, to the world of the Romans, among other things. Yes. What would be desirable, of course, what we all would like, would be a world without that tragedy. if goodness, if virtue in a Platonic sense could thrive, could flourish without that sort of death-dealing confrontation with its opposite. So tragedy isn't a good thing, you know. Tragedy results from this kind of world we have, but we can't wish it away, on the other hand. What happens with, I suppose, the narrative of the crucifixion and resurrection is that there's only one way of dealing with tragedy, and that is to try and go all the way through it and hope that you will come out somewhere on the other side. For us, there are no guarantees of that we will. But certainly to try to stare the Gorgon's head in the eyes and not be turned to stone, and in the very act of doing so, make a sort of affirmation. I think that's the classical scenario of tragedy, as much there in Plato as in the New Testament, that the tragedy is that new life can only come from the breaking of the old. And again, it would be far more convenient and pleasant and, you know, for all of us if that wasn't true. You know, if it wasn't true that we had to have a breaking down in order to have a building up, but that is, of course, at the kernel of Christianity. And baptism, you know, how did what's the first thing that happens to the baby? He dies. Well, not literally, but let's hope. But you know, baptism, of course, is about drowning, not about washing. And the first thing that they do to you when you're a little infant is symbolically drown you. Why? Because new life can only come from a turning away from the old. Yeah? It's not a smooth continuity, as so many liberals and progressivists like to think, that one can keep, as it were, accumulating and accreting enlightenment and truth and wisdom as one develops and unfolds. It's much more violent than that. It's a matter of breaking and remaking, as the great poet W.B. Yeats says, nothing can be whole or soul that has not been rent. And I think that sort of true, you know, we have to say two things about that. One is it's true, I think. And the other is, would that it were not. Because if the world went easier with us, we wouldn't need that renting in the first place.
I'd like to get into a discussion on Ophelia with you on that one, but and the death of Ophelia, but I'm not going to. I'm going to go to Neil Bliven. The New Testament, in its cultural confrontation with the Roman Empire, Neil says, suggests that the literature confronted the culture rather than the followers of Jesus and their way, casting out demons, healing the sick, loving enemies, etc., confronted the culture of the Roman Empire. Could you say something about how the values and behaviors of the Christians confronted the Roman Empire in ways that would offend some and be attractive to others?
Just on the point about Ophelia there, Mike, there's no sweeter death in Shakespeare. Shakespeare is full of death. There's no sweeter death than Ophelia's, who seems almost to die without noticing. And at the same time, it's a death tinged with a kind of weirdness and eeriness. Yeah. However, story for another time. Yes, the actions, as opposed as it were to the literature of the early church. The early church, the literature is a recording of actions, isn't it, largely, or it is itself performative. It's sermons and advice and so on. Language as performative, language as doing something, bringing people into solidarity or pitching them against an enemy. it's very hard, isn't it, in the face, I know I'm moving a little away from the question as it was asked, and I'm sorry about that, because that's a very fascinating question. But it's hard, isn't it, for us today to regain the Judaic sense, which I suppose is what it is, that where you start from is practice. I mean, there's been so much false spirituality injected into the Christian mainstream that it's about, you know, your intentions or feelings. We'll put it this way, as baldly and as brutally as I can. Love for Christianity is not about feeling. Yeah? And a world which is obsessed with erotic, romantic, sentimental, sexual, etc. love doesn't understand that. Love is about what you do. You give the hot dog to the homeless person. It doesn't matter what you feel. Who the hell is interested in what you feel? What matters is what you do. Yeah. And that's the whole ethic of charity, of agape, in scriptures, is precisely about that. This is a revolutionary form of loving, where loving is not so much a sentiment as a social practice. But our age, you know, up to its eyebrows in lovely sentiment, finds it very hard to understand that. So I think, yes, the questioner is absolutely right. It's a set of practices, exemplary practices, which are, as it were, the antidote, as I said about Mary's belly, about the child in her belly, to the institutions of empire. It's a way of doing things otherwise and treating each other otherwise, which is outlining a different way of being together, a different possibility of society and solidarity, which for the church would only ever come to full fruition in what it calls the New Jerusalem.
Thanks for that. I think Adrian Vargenis might take that a little bit further. Adrian's asking, I'm wondering whether a worldview that understands reality as materialistic, we are just stuff, allows for the moral critique you offered throughout. What would allow for the privileging of some lumps of matter over another?
Yeah. Oh, well, we're not just stuff. I mean, the most important question there is just. What does it mean to be just stuff? I mean, the stuff we're made of is fantastic. You know, as I said before, it's expressive, communicative, relational, self-transformational, self-transcendent, and so on. You know, this is marvelous stuff. The fact that it's material doesn't make any difference to that, because presumably we don't use the word material. I mean, Christians don't use the material in a degrading or negative sense, because, you know, the material world is of God. It's good because he made it. So I don't know that. First of all, I'm not quite sure of the word material, worldview there. The question talks about a materialist worldview. Worldview seems to me far too contemplative. You know, materialism proper means for me that if you want to understand something in the end, fundamentally, you understand feeling or relationship or thought, you look at what people do. Wittgenstein once said, rather enigmatically as usual, it is what we do that lies at the bottom of our language games. We say what we do and we feel what we do because of what we do. Yes. And what we do is our material activity together. And from that flows all sorts of thoughts and systems and worldviews and so on. But the root for a materialist is what we do, either together or against one another. And that's certainly a lively and, if you like, you know, spiritual enough, though I don't accept that kind of distinction really, for it to be not just a matter of lumps of material stuff, but lumps of material stuff of great value and preciousness.
Thanks for that. I'm going to go to the last question again. I know there's some more, but we're starting to run out of time. But Anna Blackman asks, thank you so much for a wonderful and insightful talk. I'm very interested in what you were saying about the pitfalls of liberal dialogue and encounter. How do you see a way forward in situations of cultural conflict and confrontation? Does encounter have a role to play, or is it misguided?
Yes, no, I think it does. I think she's right about that, it does. But as I said before, I think I said in my talk something like, I can't remember now, something like, there are plenty of conflicts in the world that's negotiable, yes? But there are some situations in which somebody's going to have to win and somebody's going to have to lose. And that's what the liberal doesn't want to hear. Yeah? Liberal's fine with the first bit, you know, compromise, negotiation. There is no middle way between racism and non-racism. What is it? What's the middle way? Semi-racism? You know? In the end, the power struggle between women and the system they're fighting, whatever you want to call it, is not resolvable by compromise. It's resolvable by transforming the system. Yeah? So that people don't have to feel unhappy or miserable about their lives. One must remember that the idea that simply by adjustment and goodwill all round, you can achieve what you want, that's a ruling class idea. Yeah? When you say, you know, I mean, who finds that convenient? Who finds that convenient? The people who are actually in some way benefiting in terms of power or prosperity or privilege from the situation. That's one of the drawbacks. I touched on the idea of inclusiveness, and I said inclusion in what? You know,
yeah.
Not a question that's very often asked, as though somehow magically being included in some greater whole was ipso facto a value or a virtue. It's not. If the traditional revolutionary force, whether whatever form it takes, has been that which the system cannot in the end absorb or assimilate or adjust to without a radical transformation of the system itself. Not just fit in, you know, fit round the edges, suitably marginal people and so on, but that the price of justice in the end, the price of justice for everybody has to be that the you come to a limit of reformism. You know, you come to a limit in terms of the amount the system itself can adjust, negotiate, temporize, moderate, and so on. And that's the point where you have a stark contradiction. Now, not all conflicts, as I said before, are of that kind. And normally, conflicts which are of that kind are won by the dominant forces. Why are they won by the dominant forces? Because they've got more tanks than we have. because they've had a very long time to build up, consolidate, marshal, diversify their various powers. And the history of the working class movement and of its allies, say the women's movement or elsewhere, has very much been one of failure or at best half success. Reform rather than transformation. And the strange thing about the Christian gospel, you know, which is nothing if not realistic about what will happen to you if you stick your neck out for justice, they'll chop your head off. Strange thing, even so, is that it insists that in some way we can't really understand the forces of justice and love have won, in principle. Yeah. And that the powers of the world, as St. John very darkly calls them, have been ousted in principle. Now, it doesn't look that way if you're reading the newspapers. So that's very kind of hard to understand. But that's one of the extraordinary aspects of human history in that respect, it seems to me, is the utter intransigence of the call for justice, which again and again is humiliated and defeated and beaten and springs back once more. I would use the example of Palestine at the moment as exemplary here. It's very, very difficult to crush those demands entirely, and ruling classes and ruling forces have an enormously difficult problem on their hands in, you know, fixing things up here and then they're coming loose there and so on. So it isn't as gloomy as one might feel. It's just that one has to remember that the powers of the world are not only powers, you know, but that they are quite prepared to kill and maim and murder, if that is the price they have to pay for their privilege and freedom and power. And that's the situation that we're left in now.
Thanks, Terry. It's been a terrific 90 minutes or so, or however long we've been on. But I'm going to have to bring it to a close there. It's been a really stimulating paper.
Not at all. Thank you so much.
Can I thank also Georgetown University for supporting this series, especially the President Jack DeJoy and Vice President Global Affairs Tom Bunchoff, and thanks also to the administrators at Georgetown, Julia and Mary. I'd like to thank Blackfriars, especially John O'Connor, the Regent, and Richard Finn, the Director of Las Casas Institute, and their administrator, King Rona Gavnai, and to Maggie Scott at Oxford Scott Education Limited. For our next event, we have an exciting young scholar, Anna Blackman, who just asked the question, who is a lecturer at Glasgow University. She will be discussing White Teeth by Zadie Smith. It's a treat, and it's next Monday on the 30th of October, Monday 30th of October. It will be at 11 a.m. US Eastern Time, but that next week is actually 3 p.m. GMT, earlier than usual, which is our 4 p.m. slot, earlier than usual in the UK as our clocks go back before the clocks go back in the USA. So it's 3 p.m. if you're in the UK next Monday. I hope you'll also join us for the event on the 13th of November when Professor Dan Shaw from Georgetown University will be discussing Milton's Paradise Lost. And more talks are to come as we go through the academic year, and some pretty exciting ones, I can tell you. But they've all got to live up to today. Terry, many, many thanks. Thank you, everybody, for participating. I'm Mike Scott from Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on X now, which was Twitter, at Mike Scott Prof. Thank you all very much for joining us. Goodbye.